Have you ever held a newborn and just marveled at its tiny sleeping face, wondering what's going on in that little head? I know I have, and it is really remarkable. And it all starts even before babies open their eyes or hear their first lullaby. We used to think of those baby brains as blank slates, passively waiting for the world around them to shape them. But what we're realizing is that they're far from quiet. They're buzzing with activity, laying the groundwork for everything that comes later. So before any sensory information comes in, there's already a symphony playing inside those little heads. And it's not just any symphony. It's a very particular kind of neural activity, often synchronized, simultaneous bursts of electrical impulses sweeping across entire networks. It looks like a wild electrical storm, but it's not wild at all. It's carefully orchestrated and precisely coordinated every step of the way. And that's because this activity has a very particular role. It shapes and molds the connections between neurons, preparing the brain to process the world around it. It's like the brain is running its own internal program even before it has any sensory data to work with. Sometimes those bursts of activity are generated deep inside the brain, and sometimes they're generated by things like small movements. You know those little squirms and twitches that babies do in their sleep? Even those tiny movements can play a crucial role in wiring the brain. And as the brain matures, this activity changes dramatically. It's no longer about those big synchronized bursts that propagate across entire networks. Instead, activity becomes much more sustained, more spread out, and less predictable. It's what we call decorrelated. Just like a conductor shapes the performance of an orchestra, here the activity in the brain goes through precise stages of its song, from those big neural waves, like neural fireworks, to something that's much more sophisticated and refined, like a nuanced symphony. And who is that conductor? In early brain development, many neurons are active. Many neurons are firing together. And inhibition plays an increasingly important role. Inhibition needs to be there in order to tone down that activity, to prevent it from going wild, because this could be very harmful to the developing brain. So it's not just that you need some activity to form those connections, but you need to be able to control that activity so that the connections are refined at the right time and at the right intensity. So how do we actually go from those big electrical storms to actually thinking about and perceiving the world? How do these bursts of activity actually shape and mold the connections between neurons? And the answer lies in a remarkable process that's known as activity-dependent synaptic plasticity. Imagine a forest where there's many possible paths to take, but nobody really knows which of those paths will become important. This is just like in the developing brain. Neurons are still figuring out which of those connections they will need. And so just like in the brain, where you have these big synchronous events that propagate through the network, there are wild animals that wander through the forest, that cross particular paths, even before we start regularly using those paths. And as these random footsteps patter through the forest, some of the paths begin to emerge, but initially they're still very faint. The more activity happens, the more some paths get a head start ahead of each other. And over time, the more activity happens, these paths become stronger, clearer, and well-trodden. And the ones that aren't used simply fade away and disappear. This is just like in the developing brain, those initial synchronous bursts of activity establish those first connections that the brain will need. But just like in the forest, those connections need to become stronger. So the more active the neurons are, the stronger and more long-lasting those connections become. It's a gradual process of refinement, of carefully sculpting the network into its final form. And it all hinges on the precise coordination of mechanisms, the generation of those synchronous bursts of activity, and those plasticity mechanisms that actually combine together to shape and mold the connections. It's almost like an intricate dance where every step and every move is crucial for the final performance. And to really grasp the power of this, let's look at a specific example. The development of vision, even before a baby opens its eyes. Here, the retinas, which are the light-sensitive parts of the eye, generate spontaneous bursts of activity that propagate through the retinas in the form of waves, and they're known as retinal waves. In animals like the mouse, we can get direct access to these retinal waves and actually visualize them. And what we find that these retinal waves are far from random, and they contain important information to wire the visual system even before the eyes open. These retinal waves are important for the creation of what we call the retinotopic map in a brain area that's known as the visual cortex. Here in the visual cortex, neighboring neurons represent neighboring points in visual space. And just like those retinal waves, these visual cortical neurons are also spontaneously active in development. They show their own patterns of spontaneous activity, but they look different. They don't look like waves. They look rather like epileptic bursts that cross the entire cortical surface. We can simulate these two types of events, the spontaneous cortical bursts on one hand and the retinal waves, in a computational model, and investigate the relative roles of each of them to create those precise connections in the visual system, to create that retinotopic map. And what we find is that we need a delicate balance between these two types of activity patterns to create the appropriate connections and that representation of the visual world into the brain. Moreover, the models tell us that these cortical bursts are somehow special. They act a little bit like volume controllers. They adjust to the relative intensity of the music, which is the activity in the brain, to carefully regulate how much of the connections they change. So clearly, all of this activity is important to sculpt those connections in the visual system. But we shouldn't just think that it's all about bringing only external information and imprinting it onto the brain. This process is also about being able to perceive and understand and somehow process this information in a more sophisticated way. It's like if you're building a city. On one hand, you need the major highways. These are the express routes that bring information in and out of the city. But you also need those smaller roads and the back streets, as well as the local transportation system, like the trams and the buses, to connect distant parts of the city together. In the brain, we need to allow for intricate conversations between neurons to happen. These are called recurrent connections. Specifically, in the visual cortex, we need to connect neurons that have very similar tuning properties. This means neurons that respond to similarly oriented edges, or neurons that respond to objects that move in a similar direction, or neurons that respond to similar color. They may be located in very different parts of the brain, far away from each other, but they still need to be connected to share information and create a coherent perception of the visual world around us. And again, here, those activity-dependent synaptic plasticity mechanisms play a key role. The more active those neurons are, the stronger the connections between them become. they form then functional subnetworks. It's like connecting neighborhoods on different parts of the city together. So how can we make sure that all of this happens at the right time? How can we make sure that those big electrical storms of neural activity don't just destroy those carefully formed connections early in development? And the answer lies in inhibition, the brakes of the brain. Inhibition operates to bring a counterbalance, to make sure that all of this self-organization is kept in check. It's like a precisely controlled traffic system that controls the flow of traffic in and out of the city, or controls the flow of information in and out of the brain. This inhibition needs to make sure that the brain maintains a balance, that you have enough excitation for those connections to initially form, but that there's also enough inhibition, this controller, to make sure that all of it stays in check. This is an important concept for the developing brain, this excitation and inhibition balance. It is not static, it is dynamic, and it is constantly changing throughout development. There are different types of inhibition that all operate together at different timescales to create the optimal environment at different stages of development. So it's not just about having the break. It's about having the right kind of brakes applied at the right time and with the right amount of pressure. It's really remarkable to think that all of these mechanisms work together in those developing baby brains, like an intricate dance that lays the very foundation of who we are. We've journeyed from those electrical storms of activity to the careful sculpting of connections between neurons and the establishment of this delicate balance between excitation and inhibition. And in the process, uncovered this remarkable capacity of the brain for self-organization. But we've only just scratched the surface. The beauty of the brain is not only that it is shaped by what we do, it is actually capable of shaping itself even before we're aware of it. So as you go about your day, interacting with the world, think about that amazing symphony of activity playing out inside your head and the delicate balance of forces that make it all possible. Thank you.